who is back. Welcome back.
Hello. Thank you. Nice to see you. And it's nice to be back. And wasn't that One World event a very welcome distraction last night? More than 70 artists spreading love from their homes. Lady Gaga, Taylor Swift was behind her piano in isolation. Keith Urban streamed in from Nashville and was pretty tricky standing in for all of his band. They all celebrated and supported frontline healthcare workers.
As we go to air, the government is facing an internal war over its COVID tracing app, with some MPs refusing to download it. Sydney police have issued more fines for social distancing breaches, but several beaches will reopen today. Victoria has seen a fall in the rate of community transmission, providing a promising sign restrictions could soon be eased. Term 2 starts in Queensland today, with classes going online, although schools will be open for children who can't learn from home. An extra 3 million flu vaccinations are being released to help take pressure off the health system. And Prince Harry is under fire after suggesting the coronavirus situation in Britain is better than people are being led to believe. Overseas, the death toll in the United States is nearing 40,000. 185 countries have cases of COVID-19. Nearly 2.4 million people have now been infected globally. Death toll, 162,000. But over 605,000 people have now recovered. Here's Nat.
Around Australia, there have been 44 new infections reported in the past day. There are 6,612 confirmed cases. The death toll has risen to 71. More than 4,200 people are listed as recovered. New South Wales increased by 21 cases to 2,957. In Victoria, there are 1,328 cases of COVID-19. In Queensland, there's a total of 1,009. Western Australia has 545 confirmed cases. South Australia has 435 people with coronavirus. Tasmania has reported 197 cases. There are 103 in the Australian Capital Territory, and there are 28 in the Northern Territory.
Live now to our team of reporters. First to Taylor Aiken in Canberra. Taylor, Nationals MP Barnaby Joyce is threatening to not download the federal government's COVID-19 tracking app.
Good morning, Nat. That's right. And that's despite Scott Morrison pleading with all Australians to download the app and do their bit in the fight against coronavirus. Barnaby Joyce says he has concerns over his privacy, and many Nationals constituents feel the same way, saying they don't feel comfortable with the government tracking their movements. But the government has hit back, saying that the app does not track geolocation services, but rather uses Bluetooth technology to track people who have been in contact, close contact, with a confirmed case of coronavirus for at least 15 minutes. But Barnaby Joyce says he's concerned over the security of that information.
My major concerns is, doesn't matter what they say, there's always the capacity for people to hack into it. We know that the Chinese government, at one instances, have been hacking into our computers. And for them to know that I spoke to Koshy, spoke to Sam, spoke to someone else, they're going to very quickly work out where I am. They're going to work out who I'm speaking to, and they're going to know more information about me than I want them to know.
It comes as the government plans to crack down on another part of the tech sector. Treasurer Josh Frydenberg has called on the ACCC to develop a mandatory code that would see Google and Facebook need to pay for its news content. The move will help publishers hit by an advertising collapse during the coronavirus, with many Australians looking towards traditional media to get those updates. It will be a world first, with Australia being the first jurisdiction to impose financial penalties on those content breaches, with Treasurer Josh Frydenberg saying this will be a chance to level the playing field. Nat.
Samantha Brett is at Coogee Beach in Sydney today. Beaches in some parts of the Sydney's eastern suburbs will reopen today.
That's right, Nat, and I think locals have been very excited this morning. They were here very, very early, eager to take a dip, even though the council has yet to arrive and formally open the beach. But that announcement came from Randwick Council yesterday that three of the beaches in southeast Sydney, including here in Coogee, will open today after 3 weeks of closures. The council has made it very clear, though, this is not for sitting or sunbaking. This is for exercising only, and those social distancing measures will certainly still be in place. Some people, though, are confused about the council's decision, considering Randwick council area has the 10th highest rate of COVID-19 in New South Wales. But a nearby beach that has an even higher rate, well, that is, of course, Bondi Beach. Yesterday, there were some dramatic scenes when a local man, a 54-year-old man, well, he tried to flout the rules and take a dip. Police were very quickly on the scene. He was arrested. He has now been charged and he will face court in July. Many locals there, well, they want to know when Bondi Beach will be reopened. No decision has been made on that yet. Nat?
Let's go to Nathan Templeton in Melbourne. A teenager has been arrested for breaching the lockdown laws several times, Nathan.
Yes, Nat, five times in a fortnight, if you can believe that. And the term COVIDia does seem appropriate for 18-year-old Jack Adwell, who's the first Victorian arrested for multiple breaches. On Saturday night, police decided they'd finally had enough. He was caught drinking with a group of friends. They tried to run away but were caught and he was locked up. Now, prior to that, Adwell, on April 7th, was caught in a car with three mates and he allegedly threatened officers, saying, "I will cough on you, I have the virus anyway." Anyway, the very next day, he was caught breaching twice in two separate locations. And then last Friday night, he was at it again, this time telling police the virus is not real. There is no such virus. Now, he faced court yesterday. Those five separate fines totaled more than $8,000. The magistrate reduced that to $2,500 because of his youth and the fact that he spent 12 hours in custody. Thankfully, most Victorians have been far more responsible and selfless. In fact, the rate of transmission here has reduced so much that some restrictions could be lifted next month, and possibly, the Premier says, schools could reopen sometime during term two. Nat?
And Bianca Stone is in Brisbane. School is back in Queensland today.
School is back, Nat, but it's going to look very different. Normally it'd be students who are a little bit nervous about returning to school for term two, but I think today it's going to be parents who are feeling those nerves as most students go to learning from home. It's estimated just 10% of the 870,000 students here in Queensland will physically attend class. There's still plenty of confusion about this. The Premier, Anastasia Palaszczuk, admits there will be some teething problems, especially on day one today. Schools are open, but only for children of essential workers who are required to be in the workplace, for vulnerable children and for children who won't be adequately supervised at home. Parents who are concerned are being urged to contact their school principal. Nat, it all begins at 8:45 today.
OK, thanks very much to our team of reporters there. Meantime, Queensland police have issued a huge number of fines to COVID-19 rule breakers. In the past 24 hours, officers issued 70 infringement notices to people breaching public health directions. It takes the total number of fines to 1,136, totalling at least 1.2 million since the end of March. On the spot, fines range from $1,300 for individuals to more than $6,000 for businesses. Joining me now is Queensland Police Commissioner Katarina Carroll from Brisbane. Good to see you again. What is your reaction to these infringement numbers?
Oh, Dev, look, when you consider we have 5 million people in the state, I still think they're relatively low numbers, Nat. What we're finding is our biggest breaches around quarantine issues as well as social distancing rules, and only a small percentage do breach those, but certainly it does make it awfully busy for us out in the streets when people do that.
It's been a few weeks now. Are you worried people are getting a bit complacent?
I don't think they're complacent. I actually think people are getting it. You know, when we go out and speak to people, they do understand the rules. We've always had an attitude of communication, compassion, and ultimately compliance. What we find is 98, 99% of the people are doing the right thing. But we've had some, you know, terrible situations where we've had a number of people congregating for car rallies. I mean, you would think this day and age that people wouldn't be doing that, but it certainly has taken place in the state and we've had to take action as a result.
So are there things people don't understand as well?
I think people are generally getting, what the rules are, particularly around social distancing, particularly around breaching the quarantine laws. But we certainly have a small cohort that even when we ask them to move on, we ask them to be compliant, they aren't. And ultimately, we will then take action.
Okay. Commissioner, thank you very much for your time this morning. Panicked shoppers are finally starting to settle down, but our major supermarkets are struggling to catch up, with some items still hard to find. Joining me now is Coles Chief Operating Officer Matt Swindles. Morning to you, Matt. Why is it taking so long to restock the shelves if we're not stockpiling anymore?
Well, I would say it's getting better, and that's not an excuse. That's the reality of what people would have seen certainly the last 2 weeks. The need is for time, really. And so you get this large surge in demand some 7 weeks ago, and that has to ripple its way back up the supply chain, all the way through transport, through the retailer's warehouse, through the supplier's warehouse, through the supplier's factory, and even into the supplier's raw material and ingredients providers. That all has to come back into sync. And Australia is a big country. We've got large geographical distances to cover. So putting all of that back together just takes time. And we've managed to remove restrictions as we've got those categories fixed in UHT, in fresh milk, in mince, in tissue paper, in nappies, and we will take them off more and more as we go. And we're not far off toilet paper, I think, coming off. That's the last part, the one we've been really focused on fixing. So it's time, Nat, and we are getting there.
OK, because I noticed on the weekend, even things like flour, I mean, a lot of people are at home baking. There's still quite a few holes in those supermarket shelves.
Yes, there are flour, and we've also seen baking mixes, cake mixes are on the increase as people are staying at home, as they should. They're turning their hand to baking at home, probably with the family. They're cooking more and varied recipes than ever, so people are getting back into food, which is a good thing. But again, that keeps the demand high. And flour has to be manufactured and transported and distributed and stacked. So again, we're working as hard as possible, but in some of those categories where we've still got high demand, it is going to take a bit longer.
Yep, and it's a big country to get it all out. Matt, thank you very much for your time. Good luck with it. Well, as the death toll from coronavirus nears 165,000 in the UK, Prince Harry has been slammed over comments he made about the pandemic. Let's cross live to our foreign correspondents for the latest. First to Sarah Greenoch in London. Sarah, the Prince claims the crisis is not as bad as what's been reported.
Yeah, Nat, he seems to think it's better than what the public is being told here. He made these comments during a podcast interview that he was doing from his new home in LA, but health experts here have said they are pretty outrageous. Take a listen.
I think things are better than we're led to believe through, you know, certain corners of the media. It can be very, very worrying when you're sitting there and the only sort of information you're getting is from certain news channels. But then if you're out and about or you're on the right platforms, you can really sense this human spirit coming to the forefront.
One quite high-profile doctor here has said of Harry's words, what are his qualifications for making these comments other than deserting his country in its hour of need? That, as the UK government has also come under fire for its handling of the outbreak in the lead-up to the pandemic. Downing Street has defended its actions, saying all the right moves were made at the right time, but the Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, has been accused of sleepwalking into the crisis. There is a critical shortage here of protective gear for frontline doctors and nurses, and a shipment of 84 tonnes was meant to arrive today from Turkey. It hasn't arrived. There has been a delay. The UK's death toll now stands at more than 16,000, while Europe's combined death toll is now more than 100,000. Nat?
And Paul Kadic is in New York. Thousands have come out in protest, Paul, over tough new lockdown measures.
Yeah, good morning, Nat. Over the last couple of days, we've seen these fairly noisy rallies in various states. A new one today in Colorado. Protesters saying that the stay-at-home rules that are in place are a blow to liberty and freedom, as much as they're concerned about the impact of the economic impact of them. The counter-argument, of course, being that they are there to protect the public health. But it's all part of the debate going on right now in the US about when is the right time to reopen. Some states have indicated they're ready to make those first moves within the next few days. The key, everyone agrees, though, is testing, being able to test people en masse and quickly to work out who's got the virus and who's had the virus. Now, Donald Trump says the states have all the testing capacity they need. They just need to get on with it. But state governors have today responded to that, calling it delusional and absolutely false. Experts say that the US may need to triple its amount of testing. Here in New York, more positive signs that the spread is being halted, but still caution, it's still too early to relax restrictions.
If the data holds and if this trend holds, we are past the high point, and all indications at this point are that we are on a descent. We can control the beast. Yes, but the beast is still alive. We did not kill the beast. And the beast can rise up again.
A beast that has now claimed more than 40,000 American lives, Nat.
Okay, thank you both.